Today is November 7th, 2019. 102 years ago, the devil, dark, and the terrorist forces inside Russia was combined with the 19th century most absurd and rotten theory, the communism, turned Russia upside down, interrupted the natural historical development of Russia.The Russian people went through a disastrous time for 74 years until December 25th, 1991, when Russia restored its normal historical process. I hereby present my work, The Dawn of Russia.I am currently in the beautiful southern city, Houston.Receiving treatment to my late-stage cancer. I'm by nature hate wasting time, and I feel I've been in debt to Russia. In the last 2 months, I took the opportunity of staying in Houston for cancer treatment, finished this carbon drawing of the dawn of Russia. Some of my friends advised that I do a brief accountof the content of this drawing so as not to forget this part of Russian history. I agree that I have the responsibility to lay out a description. Russia is named the testimony of a human sphinx, with its double-headed hawk, facing east as well as the west. It belongs to Europe and to Asia at the same time.In the entire world, Russia is the only country stretching from Europe to Asia. Its spirit is intensely split. So is its history and religion. An intense internal conflict. In my words, Russia has been dominated by two internal forces. The imperialist force that exhibits...the dark, warlike, barbaric, and conquering, and also the opposite, seeking redemption, freedom, future, and Messiah, soul, salvation. The latter was mainly carried out by Russian poets. From the birth of Pushkin in 1799,Russians began to express their spiritual quest in their own language, in poems. Please allow me to offer you two stories. First, on December 26, 1825, the elite of Russia, purely out of love for their country, those army officers,who followed Alexander to France, drafted their version of a Russian constitution, hoping to change the Russian Empire. Their version is totally comparable to the French constitution, the Great Charter of Britain, and the US Constitution. Their way to demand change.was armed uprising. in the Russian square of Pittsburgh, 3,200 soldiers, officers publicly demanded that Nicholas I accept their constitution and the Tsar dictatorship, which brought shame, infamy, and calamity to Russia. They were brutally cracked down. The other, an equally significant spiritual manifesto, before Pushkin passed away, Pushkin wrote a poem for himself, The Tombstone. I built myself a tombstone, not of mancraft, no grass grown along the way to it, and held high its unconquerable head, standing high on the stone path of Alexander. The young Pushkin, at age 36, said, I shall never die, as long as there is a poet under the moonlight, because in the hard times, I called for freedom, awakened the conscience and the soul in the Russians. History proves that the two conflicting forces, empire and poets, power and the spirit of freedom, are in constant struggle to shape the modern Russian history. 30 years ago, the Russian Soviet Communist Empire dramatically collapsed. The giant communist empire just vanished overnight. Till today, the experts in this field studying Kremlin, including those in the US, are pondering what on earth brought down this daunting red empire. There were not any apparent or insurmountable crisis, let alone wars waged by the West, like the military invasion by the Germans, not even any natural calamities. How to explain the sudden collapse of this huge communist empire? Here's my explanation. It's the result of two internal forces embattled against each other, the empire against the free spirit. The secondary factor was the Cold War, during which the West isolated and sanctioned the former Soviet Union. But this was not the fundamental reason. If not so, the Cold War could have given rise to military confrontation between the West and the Soviet Union, as the two crises demonstrated, the Berlin Wall crisis and the Cuban Missile Crisis. The true reason of Soviet collapse was the internal forces, the conflict between the empire and the poets. As Isaiah Berlin uniquely pointed out, no poets in any nation upheld the spirit of freedom, salvation, and redemption like the poets in Russia. The self-reform of all artists was pioneered and realized by Russian poets. I'm not here to comment, good or bad, because the method of two extreme analyses has long been outcast from my thinking. Now let's turn our attention to the drawing, the Dawn of Russia. The structure is simple, left, right, up and down. On the left are the poets and the cross, representing Sir Vladimir accepting Christianity from Byzantine in AD 988, the Messiah salvation. Upper left, a cold and a mysterious Russian moon. On its right is an ancient abbey on Salvisky Island. This island was turned to be a political concentration camp during Soviet rule. This symbolizes the cruel and bloody governing of the 20th century Soviet communists. On the right is Pushkin, the symbol of the bitter time in 20th century. Behind him is a massive gallows with victims hung on it. The use of deadly force against its own people, asking for freedom, was the strongest weapon of the empire possessed. It's the nature and the character of the Red Empire, expressed here by the surveillance tower in front of the gallows. In the center is the tricolor flag, which was adopted by Peter the Great in 1699, copied the concept from the West, an effort to merge into the West. The flag was raised high in Russian sky for over 300 years. White, blue, red, respectively, represents the values that the Russians adhere to: noble, sacrifice, compassion, and saint. This flag was replaced in the Soviet Communist Revolution in 1917 by another flag at the bottom of this drawing. This flag, designed by Vladimir Lenin himself, very eye-catching to its own right. The sickle and hammer, just as the Nazi flag was designed by Hitler himself. Both Lenin and Hitler were very talented, very evil talents. This flag was truly well designed. The sickle and hammer, the honor as well as the main tools of working people. History showed us they are no longer just tools. Once put together on this flag, it resembles terror, oppression, slavery, blood, and darkness. After 74 years, this flag fell to the ground. In this drawing, it symbolizes a shameful corpse cover. Beneath this fallen flag lie five famous Russian poets: Mayakovsky, Fatigiev, Yashnyachin, Markov, and Trotsky. Trotsky is a revolutionary, the first commissioner of the Soviet Military Commission. They all lay under this bloody flag, sacrificed their life in the Soviet Revolution. These two flags are the mini reflection of the 74 years history of Russia in 20th century. This part of history is a horrific, bloody, but eternal, great, and noble at the same time. The lesson and the revelation warrant our commemoration. In between these two flags, under the cold moonlight, I selected over 60 historical figures lived in the 20th and some in the 19th century. Russia produced abundant talents, just like stars in the sky. From Pushkin in the 19th century to Solzhenitsyn, the two figures holding the tricolor flag are Trotsky and Solzhenitsyn. The former is a symbol of the peak achievement of Russian literature in 19th century, also a symbol of the brightest side of humanity. Solzhenitsyn is somewhat greater in the sense that his masterpiece, Gulag Island, and other pieces directly announced the illegitimacy of the Soviet communism. In a broader sense, He overpowered the communist empire with the power of his works. So Zhenqin left us many well-known phrases, one of which I hereby solemnly offer to you. Those nations that wish to build an empire are doomed to disasters. He indicated the Russia, which indeed built an empire with destructive power to destroy the world many times over. Then he said, but an empire by nature is not compatible with a nation with a high morality and a noble heart. This is his verdict to the right empire. As history has proved, 66 million lives were lost under the Red Empire. Unprecedented in Russian history and in world history as well. So Zhenqin believed the cure for his nation and the soul was the belief in Christ, who could comfort and purify the Russian soul. His religious belief is not our topic today. So Zhenqin, in his prison uniform, right here, number 202, held high the tricolor flag. Behind him was Trotsky, his soul brother and writer. Around them are other talents, Tchaikovsky, Berlinsky, Chekhov, Pushkin, etc. Chekhov was born into a doctor's family. His short stories were one of a kind. He visited many Soviet jails, through which he entered the bitter darkness of Russian soul. His works were full of quest for human dignity and freedom. Below them are some 20th century figures. Rachmaninoff, Shostov, Brezhnev, Bechayev, and an outstanding religious philosopher. He believed that the extreme sad experience of Russia and Germany in the 20th century was due to the transition of spirit, redemption to nihilism. The total silence buried the light of spirit. We might not agree with him, but at least the Chinese could not cherish such thought. On the left side, Herzen, Kropotkin, Bakunin, etc. This is Solovyov, a 47-year-old gifted philosopher who enlightened several generations, including Dostoevsky and Trotsky. Here is Dostoevsky, the last survivor of the gallows, a great writer. Below him is Tarkovsky, a representative of the radicalism in that time. As for their argument and historical position, it is not our discussion today. On their chest were the board announcing their death sentence, revealing the bloody dark age of Romanov dynasty. This Russian Jew and the greatest Russian playwright in the 20th century, Chivlinki, author of Dr. Zhivago, a great Jewish writer whom I truly admire. And here is Maxim Gorky, here in an awkward position. He was a vehement supporter of the Bolshevik Revolution and an opposer at once. He was crowned the father of a proletarian literature, but was strongly dubious about the Stalin style of bloody rule. He exiled himself to Italy for 10 years. Anyway, Gorky is in an awkward position in this drawing. Now, let's look at the key figure here. Sakharov. He is the brain behind the Russian thermonuclear weapon. Out of nothing but conscience, he embarked the rocky path of advocating human rights and humanitarianism. Thus, he was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize in 1975. Right beside him is the central figure of this drawing. Rostrovsky, the most temperamental man, fond of fine wine, pretty women, and beautiful music. He was extremely courageous and creative. He was on site and played solo when the Berlin Wall fell, and he flew to Moscow, played solo when the Communist Soviet Union collapsed. By the way, the romantic characteristic exhibited by Russians is truly lacking in the Chinese. The Chinese are too realistic. This is Kaplan. She was a young constitutionalist, attempted to assassinate Lenin. She was cruelly executed. Postovsky, who created the fairy tales that can be mentioned together with those by Hans Christian Andersen, in the sense of its love for humanity and human nature. Very touching. Now, these three ladies, one of the most talented white Russian poets, and her husband, Meskovsky. Of course, they had the money. They had the key to number 11 residence on Secret Fig Street in Paris. Nothing that the exiled people like us could think of. The abundant works they produced had a great influence on the world, but unknown to the Chinese. In their 50 years marriage, they never separated even one single day. A love story is not our topic today, but worth pointing out. The 20th century Chinese lovebirds had a long way to catch up. These few people here are very special. All dead in an unnatural way. Babel, the composer of the Lead Cavalry Overture, nominated the king of short stories in 21st century. He was executed for reason of not getting along with Pushkin, a Red Army marshal. On his chest was a small board with a painted little bird on it. The Soviet government, with a slight trace of humanity, would snap a portrait of the death prisoner and a side picture. The 19th century Tsar tradition, giving the would-be dead a last chance to express his attitude. Under Mao's rule in China, the executed prisoners never had such a luxury. They never left a decent photo before they were killed. This is Mandelsdorf, a gifted poet. Above him is Gumilov, a handsome young man, poet. Along with him is his wife, Akhmatova. Akhmatova was the representative of women poets. The most famous poem from her is Requiem. She said, Pluto hung high above us, The innocent Russia is struggling to survive. The iron bloody heel tread over Russia to its death. Her life was full of sufferings. Her first husband was executed. She remarried, the same fate. Her children were imprisoned. She was one time waiting in a long queue outside of the prison to visit her children. Ahead of her, a pale woman turned around. "Could you write down all this?" she quietly whispered. Akhmatova accepted the mission, thus giving birth to the great requiem. Beside her is Chutayava, my special respect to her. Her fate was no less unfortunate than that of Akhmatova. They were all born into well-to-do families. Her father was the founder of Moscow Art Museum. Her mother was a pianist. For the love of her country, she returned to Soviet Union when the war broke out. The Soviet government refused her. She could not find anywhere to stay. Nowhere to stay, nowhere to work. Out of despair, she hung herself. The two ladies here embraced the cross. Above her is the fifth Russian Nobel Literature Prize winner, Polinsky, who insisted Tsutyawa was the greatest poet of the 20th century, not just in Russia, but in the entire world. I can't offer any comment here, since I myself am not a poet. Bulgakov, a theologist. Okay, this guy here is myself, sitting quietly in this corner. This is the tradition of European Renaissance, giving the artist the privilege of a corner spot. Raphael positioned himself beside Todi in a painting of the School of Athens, humble and respectful. I did the same for myself. Deep in my soul, I feel I were a Russian, an admirer of Russian poets and their spirit. At the right corner, lower corner, a few nameless but equally great people, a family of four. A small family. The father was a bag of bones. So was his wife, their eldest son, and their dying young son. They were the victims of the great Soviet famine in the 30s. Ukraine, North Caucasus, along the Volga River, a great famine took place. Dead bodies were all over. A U.S. humanitarian organization offered help with one precondition. They would come with a camera. By the way, the Great Chinese Famine in the early 60s was times worse than this one. But there was no help from any foreign country. Not a single photo was taken. Another kid, dying of hunger. Need to particularly point out this little girl with her begging bowl held a small flower in her hand. I obtained this inspiration from Schindler's List. Even in such hopeless situation, the little girl expressed her love for life and beauty, the little red flower. The longing for good life is the root of all free souls. This small red flower with a tricolor flag at the top and the communist flag at the bottom all share one thing, the red color. These three symbols, the three periods in history, cannot substitute one another, but together they formed a complete 20th century Russia. Finally, I sincerely pray for Russia. I want to sing blessing for Russia, a suffering but noble and a great nation. I believe it's worth our prayer. I know in this 21st century, the dawn of Russia will arrive. The great Russia and the cold moon will once again become the hope on the continent that links Europe to Asia. Let me quote from Isaiah Berlin, who received excellent education with a noble heart. He once said, "Once the Russians regain their freedom, revive their soul, the Russian intellectuals will bring wonders to this world." Berlin's words gave me abundant inspiration in this drawing. I hereby wrap up this description of the drawing, the dawn of Russia. Thank you.